Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Analyst's Vulnerability, Impact on Theory and Practice, by Karin J. Maroda, narrated by Senn. Introduction. In this book, I examine our early childhood experiences and argue that all therapists share certain circumstances from that period in their lives. Perhaps we share as well in a genetic endowment toward empathic attunement to important others. I specifically discuss both the strengths and weaknesses that result from having been assigned the enormous responsibility of caregiving at an early age. The outcome is an overdetermined preconsciousness on our part, as well as a deep sense of having missed something important that we needed. We relive our pasts as we treat our patients, deriving both pleasure and pain as we revisit emotional terrain that can be achingly familiar. In addition, we often favor theoretical approaches and interventions that sometimes fall too easily into either a repetition of our own pasts or a defense against experiencing that repetition. I have divided this book into two parts in an attempt to address both how our early experiences created the people we are today and how this gets enacted in our choice of theory and technique. Part 1 is devoted to our motivations, our vulnerabilities, our needs, our sacrifices, and our gratifications. Part 2 examines how our personal traits and histories become part of the fabric of our theories and interventions. I discuss our avoidance of conflict, our preference for enactment over direct intervention, our misapplied confidence in mirror neuron theory, and how we create our theories of therapeutic action. Writing this book was challenging, both emotionally and intellectually. I hope one will feel equally challenged in the hearing of it. Part 1. The Analyst as a Person. Chapter 1. The Analyst's Early Experiences. Anyone who has chosen to become an analytic clinician is keenly aware that there is something deep and primitive about that decision that eludes understanding. We readily acknowledge the positive and obvious reasons for our choice, like wanting to help others and have meaningful work. Yet most of us are aware of deeper needs being met by doing therapy. The same is true for our theories and the ways in which we prefer to work with patients. The purpose of this chapter is to orient one to the idea that everything about why we became therapists, how we build our theories, and how we practice is significantly shaped by our own early experiences. I want to begin by looking at some of the early experiences that contribute to our vocational choice. I will then explore the numerous related issues that include our fear of doing harm, our tendency toward passivity rather than action, our ambivalence about technique, our need to see ourselves in an overly positive light, the personal nature of our theories, and the impact of gender within the transition from classical to relational analysis. In A Curious Calling, Michael Sussman speaks openly and extensively about both our motivations for doing treatment and the ongoing gratification for the therapist that is essential, albeit largely unconscious. He notes that if you ask therapists why they chose their profession, you will get generic answers about wanting to help people, doing something to change the world, wanting to solve problems, and making money. The point of his work, and my own, is that our true reasons for being therapists are mostly unconscious, although capable of being brought into awareness, and have historically been ignored as a subject for scrutiny, even in personal analysis. Some of the finest minds in psychoanalysis have addressed this subject, but somehow it has never gained traction. Jacobs acknowledges that our reasons for becoming therapists have much to do with our early childhood experiences, particularly being the sensitive, empathic child who provides comfort to a depressed mother. Searles reflects on the common therapist experience of guilt, questioning its origins. Thus, it may not be so much that our doing of analysis tends to promote guilt in us, but rather that we originally entered this profession in an unconscious effort to assuage our guilt, and that the practice of analysis fails to relieve our underlying guilt. For example, we may have chosen this profession on the basis of unconscious guilt over having failed to cure our parents. More important for our ongoing work as clinicians is that we, just like our patients, carry these early experiences and motivations with us for a lifetime. The goal for us, and for them, is not to rewrite history, but rather to bring it into awareness in the interests of greater conscious control and less internal conflict. As we treat other people, we are necessarily working through our own issues and attempting to overcome our guilt and become the best people we can be. As Kite insightfully observes, I will go on to suggest that the personal history of the analyst, known or not, understood or not, has everything to do with how we live our version of analysis, and a great deal to do with how our patients experience us. I will also suggest that we may become analysts in the first place in order to clarify who we are ethically to ourselves. In this way, we attempt to redeem and save ourselves. In some sense, this is our greatest strength, our need to help others. We were rewarded early in our lives for being unusually sensitive and empathic. Over time, we naturally extended this skill set into a career choice. But this embedded need to relieve others of their pain can also be our greatest weakness, in that we are prone to taking too much responsibility for their distress. Doing so produces excessive guilt in response to our patients not doing well, particularly if they are blaming us for their suffering, as they often will. Making things more complicated is our potential guilt for what Brenner referred to as our wish to see another suffer. We become analysts to prove, in part, that we are not destructive, that the pain in our families was not our fault. We survive and assuage our guilt in doing so by spending our days attempting to emotionally connect with others. As Chalenza says, the skill of using ourselves to help others find themselves coincides with our own pressing need to heal ourselves and to do so by finding ourselves in the other. A supervisee of mine, who had the benefit of being well into middle age, surprised me at the onset of our work together by simply stating that her new patient's history of being unloved and rejected by her mother resonated deeply with her own similar experience. She added that feeling her patient's pain took her to an even deeper experience of her own pain, even though she had explored this thoroughly in her personal analysis. She said this in a matter-of-fact way, with no guilt or shame, something I have rarely seen. We agreed that we never lose the ability to revisit our own painful experiences, and she felt hopeful about helping this very difficult patient achieve some of what she had achieved in life. She wanted more for her. She readily admitted to feeling guilty that she had a husband and children, plus an analysis early in her life, unlike her occasionally homeless patient. She also had no illusions of being able to save her, focusing instead on simply helping her to improve the quality of her inner and outer existence. Her frank admission and acceptance of the gratification she experienced in working with this patient, combined with an equally deep understanding of the potential for this identification to go awry, made for a potentially compelling experience for me as well. Working with therapists who understand their own countertransference repetitions and who are eager to explore them in their work makes for both a better therapeutic outcome and a better supervisory experience. A personal story. In the interests of transparency, I will disclose some of my own motivations for becoming an analyst. My mother came to the United States from Australia, having married my father there during World War II. To put it mildly, she never adjusted to being here. My father's parents came over from Hungary and spoke little English. His sisters did not care for my mother and resented her for coming from a significantly higher socioeconomic class. They thought her haughty with her highbrow British-sounding accent. When people called the house, they thought we had a maid. My mother became wearily accustomed to jokes about kangaroos and questions about whether or not her family was descended from criminals. They weren't. My mother was naturally quite playful and charming. She loved music and laughed easily. She was warm and nurturing. I loved her deeply. But she was also incredibly sad and lonely. My father was a workaholic, and she depended on her three children for company. My older sister resented her neediness. My twin brother felt overwhelmed by it. I anguished over her pain and worked daily to take it away. When she was terribly upset with us for misbehaving, she would emptily threaten to go back to Australia, then apologize later for speaking out of frustration and anger. Looking back, I think I took on the job of making sure she didn't ever really want to leave. My story is not just about fear of loss and excessive responsibility for my mother's feelings. It is also implicitly a story of ambivalence. As much as I loved my mother, I also hated her passivity, her seeming unwillingness to make a genuine effort to assimilate and build a life for herself, and her expectations that I would be a consistent, soothing presence. As I write this, I am aware of my own warnings about the possible idiosyncratic nature of theory building. Nonetheless, I think it reasonable to suggest that to the extent that therapists were their mother's keepers, they also would share this ambivalence. I will leave it to the listener to decide. During my childhood, I was not aware of these feelings, of course, but I did become aware of them in adolescence, especially in the face of my older sister's rage at my mother. This is only a keyhole into my childhood experiences, and I have observed myself confronting many aspects of my relationships and my family, including with my siblings, in the course of doing treatment. I will also add that my early interest in countertransference came both from my own intense feelings toward my patients and desire to rescue them, and also from experiencing my analyst's intense countertransference to me. The power of countertransference is, in part, my account of that struggle. I want to insert the caveat that I do not think it necessary for analysts to describe the details of their early childhood experiences when they present or publish, since no one is entitled to this very personal information. And many would question this practice, given that patients would potentially have access to this material. I think we could do justice to our early contributions simply by weaving this idea into the narrative of what we believe and how we practice. When describing a particular encounter with a patient, we might simply make reference to some general aspect of our own personalities or early life that contributed to what was going on, be it positive or negative. Accepting that our own motivations and needs play a major role in our professional identity and daily clinical work has the potential for changing the narrative in a profound way. The fear of doing harm. From Freud's early admonitions to act like a surgeon to current controversies regarding any systematic use of self-disclosure, the theme that consistently arises is that of potential harm. From my perspective, this fear of doing harm exceeds the expectable caution born out of legitimate professional concern for doing right by the patient. Since most analysts are very decent, hardworking, dedicated professionals, why would such a fear be so pervasive? I think Searle's argument about our shared guilt goes a long way in understanding these edicts. Even if it is suppressed, at some level we all know that we are getting some personal needs met in our relationships with our patients. Is the hidden knowledge of this personal benefit producing so much guilt and shame that we need to overemphasize our role as not only good enough caregivers, but also as self-sacrificing humanitarians? Moreover, to what extent is this fear of harming patients a reaction formation in response to the repressed anger that arises from our internal mandate to put others first? Although it is quite evident from reading the literature that our fear of doing harm is substantial, there is little discussion of why this is so. On this topic, Proger cites Storr, saying, Storr makes similar points about the personality of the therapist. Anecdotal evidence points to a high incidence of depressed mothers amongst trainee psychotherapists who acquired a sensitivity through judging her moods. They also learned to put their own feelings secondary to hers, another prerequisite for the therapist. Making demands often then leads to guilt and fears of damaging others in relationships. Putting others first is the safe option, but inevitably means repression of aggression. Thus, our unfailing preoccupation with being good can be seen as a reaction formation, an irrational defense against our own guilt and anger about having precociously surrendered our own well-being. Focusing on the needs of others and developing a finely tuned ability to instantly read in others' moods necessarily produces a degree of resentment. What child wants to be his or her mother's or family's keeper? Yet, expressing this resentment runs counter to the role of soother and peacemaker, and therein lies the problem. I think that therapists of all persuasions have an aversion to expressing anger toward their patients, or even feeling it, because it stimulates this irrational fear of not only failing to soothe, but also to harm. This is the conundrum that we need to break free from. Accepting our inevitable ambivalence toward both the work itself and often toward our patients as individuals could provide the necessary momentum to advance both our theoretical formulations and our clinical interventions. Even more important is the acceptance that we are not without memory or desire. As poetic and appealing as Bion's famous line is, I think it is not a realistic approach to doing treatment. I appreciate that his prescription was meant to encourage receptivity rather than deny our personal biases and needs. Nonetheless, his words are often taken more literally, denying the considerable realities that prevent such a state from truly existing. Even as an aspirational concept, it does more harm than good, in that it sends the analyst's thinking in the wrong direction. Rather than seeking to have no needs or desires, we would benefit from expecting to have them and working to bring those needs into awareness. One might argue that Bion's words are meant to counterbalance the realities of the states of mind and biases that we naturally bring to each session. Just as with all countertransference, there will be needs of ours that arise with most patients, and those that arise less frequently, and more specifically with certain people. In any event, we all bring our own personal desires, needs, and wishes for the patient into each new treatment relationship, and we may begin a session with needs or desires that have little to do with the patient sitting before us. And even with our work ego in place, striving to minimize the impact on our patients, success is highly dependent on our own self-awareness. Striving to transcend primitive feelings of resentment, fear, despair, hopelessness, and rage only results in the need to deny these feelings or try to inhibit them when they occur. We are much more comfortable, of course, with deep experiences of joy, exhilaration, pathos, and love. Furthermore, this book pursues the concept that unconditional acceptance of the patient's negative feelings and behaviors, though easier than accepting our own, represents an unrealistic wish to both have and to be the idealized, loving mother. As Searle said, I surmise that wholehearted acceptance of the patient is another unrealizable goal. We could unambivalently love and approve of and accept our patient only if he were somehow able to personify our own ego ideal. And in that impossible eventuality, we would, of course, feel murderously envious of him anyway. Miller has elegantly detailed our need to avoid the pain of our own childhood through this largely unconscious pursuit of the good parent. Only after painfully experiencing and accepting our own truth can we be free from the hope that we might still find an undemanding, empathic parent, perhaps in a patient, who will be at our disposal. This important topic of the necessary and avoidable gratifications of the analyst will be addressed in Chapter 2. The analyst's passivity. When therapists approach me to speak about individual cases, I almost always see indications of their reluctance to be assertive. Some allow self-destructive behaviors to go unchallenged or allow too much verbal abuse from patients. Some collude to create long periods of silence, and many fail to press for overdue payment of fees. When questioned, the inevitable response focuses on the perceived fragility of the patient and the fear of hurting the patient's feelings, inciting a suicidal episode, or alienating the patient and losing him. Consultation often elicits little more than a series of yes buts that end with a therapist deciding to continue his or her existing pattern of long-suffering inaction. According to Luckner and others, the therapist may also feel that his or her ability to be selfless is proof that he or she is capable, and that without his or her ability to make specific concessions for clients, he or she would be negligent and deficient in his or her role as a psychotherapist. Our rather pronounced predilection for finding gratification in martyrdom can then be used by the therapist to rationalize self-indulgences, like extending sessions, keeping patients too long, conducting multiple times per week telephone sessions for years after the patient has moved permanently out of state, and so on. Is there any hope for changing the analyst's perfectly selfless persona? I think there is. Therapists struggle throughout their careers with a sense of guilt and shame over having their needs met by their patients. Much of the behavior unconsciously designed to compensate for this gratification, for example, being overly solicitous and parental, is unhelpful. And theory born of denying the analyst's gratification often focuses on transcending human nature rather than embracing it. For example, the aforementioned emphasis on our humanitarian and long-suffering qualities avoids any discussion of primitive rage, envy, or competitiveness. Alternately, the current emphasis on enactment prefers to see the analyst as a participant in an unconscious-to-unconscious ongoing interaction that is simply beyond any attempt at conscious control or direction. The end result is an analytic persona that revolves around unconditional acceptance and empathy, accompanied by a certain passivity in the face of the ongoing complex psychodynamics that characterize the therapeutic relationship. Much remains to be explored in the analytic dyad, as well as the reverberations occurring outside of it. I have discussed how the analyst's guilt over residual feelings of responsibility for their caregiver's pain generates guilt-based behaviors with their patients. But what about the degree of passivity that has always been characteristic of analysts, regardless of theoretical orientation? If we feel so guilty and responsible, why aren't we more motivated to be active and innovative? I think the answer lies, once again, in our early experience. As children, we did not have any real power over our parents. Once identified as empathic and sensitive, then enrolled as the family's therapist, we essentially felt enormous responsibility, with little or no power over events or the behaviors of others. All we could do was respond to the situations we were presented with, then make our best attempts to be soothing, empathic, or even entertaining. But we could not change the scenarios that were unfolding before our eyes. One could argue that any attempt to point out a suffering parent's maladaptive behavior would no doubt have resulted in rejection or further distress, something a child could not possibly endure. A recent, very moving International Association for Relational Psychoanalysis and Psychotherapy, IARPP, online colloquium focused on a paper on parental loss by Mary Joan Gerson, which prompted a flood of responses focused on the deep pain that these analysts suffered in childhood. Both their suffering and their intense ambivalence toward parents, living and dead, were palpably evident. And somewhat to my surprise, the participants were universally relieved through the act of revealing their ambivalent attachment to their parents and by the knowledge they were not alone. It is my hope that this book might contribute in a similar fashion to stimulating dialogue about our early conflicts, creating an empathic environment conducive to disclosing them. I had a therapist patient ask me recently why I am so comfortable with giving feedback and engaging in conflict when necessary. My answer is that my mother, though very needy and dependent, paradoxically also wanted her children to be free to express their own opinions and have the courage of their convictions, not to be confused with them taking precedence over hers. Nonetheless, my siblings and I were encouraged to speak our minds and be aware of our feelings. I initially assumed that most therapists were empowered in this fashion, but have discovered this is not true. I think it is vitally important that training programs put more emphasis on how our early experiences may have determined both how we feel about ourselves and our patients, and also how we think about the process. As Harris says, our blind spots arise from our own histories, as well as our places in history and culture. Another perspective on mutuality. It seems difficult for us to conceptualize mutuality as necessarily involving a degree of change and gratification for the analyst, though we may pay lip service to this idea. Both analyst and patient are motivated, ideally, to recreate our pasts with each other in the interests of making a difference that we couldn't make in childhood. The topic of the analyst's gratification should not be one of guilt and shame, but rather one of creative reliving. Again, that's why we have to treat people who we are interested in. If a patient cannot trigger an optimal degree of positive transference in us, we cannot significantly engage and help them at a deep level. What interpersonal, relational, intersubjective, field theory, and mentalization all have in common is the recognition of psychoanalysis and psychotherapy not simply as a relationship, but, if successful, one that necessarily involves a consistent mutual emotional engagement. This focus on the necessity of emotional engagement is perhaps the greatest change in not only analytic treatment, but also in all forms of therapy. Goldfried and Davila note, as Gelso and Hayes have observed, the therapeutic relationship and technique constantly interact with and influence one another. There is a profound synergism between the two. The techniques used by the therapists, for example, and certainly the manner in which they are used, influence the kind of relationship that unfolds. Likewise, how the therapist feels toward the client will have a profound effect on the techniques he or she uses and the manner in which they are used with each client. Indeed, evidence exists to support this view. The authors note that even Linehan, with her manualized responses to those with borderline personality disorder, acknowledges that once a therapeutic alliance has been established, some degree of confrontation is needed. The therapist with manual in hand cannot avoid the conflict needed for change. In spite of the inevitability of bidirectional ubiquitous communication, there remains the fiduciary responsibility to focus on the patient's needs over the analyst's, teasing out what is helpful and what is not. Movement toward new ways of being with patients has been painfully slow. The analyst's ambivalence toward technique. In speaking to groups of therapists, I have noticed the palpable tension in the room when the topic of technique arises. The chief resistance to adopting technical guidelines often centers around a certain fear that therapists will lose the freedom to be themselves, for lack of a better description. This perception that technique will rob them of their unique personalities and the needs and desires they bring to treatment creates an understandable resistance to even the most general suggestions of what works and what doesn't. Even the concept of technique often suggests some measure of artifice rather than creative spontaneity, even though this need not be the case. I think this often means that therapists fear any interference with the path they need to take to either preserve or enhance themselves. Thus, the plurality of analytic theory and practice not only exemplifies the wide range of intellectual perspectives, but also the need for analysts to resist any stance that might interfere with needed gratifications that could arise at any moment. At some level, they understand that they will necessarily play out their own early childhood dramas as their patients play out theirs, and fear that adoption of technical guidelines will prevent them from doing so. I think the following quote from Grossman illustrates what I am discussing. A theory of technique cast in terms of the analyst's behavior is an effort to make the analyst's character disappear. If it did so, we could teach analysis by teaching technique. But it does not work that way. A good analyst does not try to be someone else. He or she tries to use his or her strengths, receptivity, even the willingness to be wrong or blind or deaf at times, to good advantage. Emphasis added. I certainly agree that a good analyst does not try to be someone else. However, Grossman's view suggests an actual fear of psychic annihilation if any theory of technique is adopted. This type of fear of being so controlled as to be non-existent no doubt also emanates from parallel experiences in childhood. But to what extent does this prevent us from seriously considering not just rigid technical prescriptions, but also any meaningful discussion of what might be an effective or ineffective type of intervention under similar circumstances. No current discussion of technique proposes hard and fast rules, only the possibility of technical guidelines. Nonetheless, as Fonagy has pointed out, there are no new significant advances in technique. Some might argue that Fonagy's own work on mentalization does offer a new approach, and I would argue that my own work does as well. I think if analysts in training were encouraged to be curious about what types of interventions seemed most comfortable and most uncomfortable for them, they might gain greater insight into how their own needs necessarily determine the how and why of their personal style, and they could then adapt them accordingly. As things stand now, interventions that have been accepted as inevitable and useful, like the judicious use of self-disclosure, remain controversial. Even in case reports that use self-disclosure to good advantage, the concluding advice usually focuses on disclaiming it as preferred intervention. Rather, the emphasis remains on the uniqueness of each analytic dyad, a topic I explore further in Chapter 5 on enactment. As I have stated previously, I think there is plenty of room for discovering general principles regarding interventions while allowing space for the analyst's individual style, personality, level of comfort, and even immediate need. No relationship, no matter how asymmetrical, can survive without some accommodation to the other's needs. The question I pursue in this book is how we can incorporate a recognition and incorporation of our neediness into a model that retains a primary focus on helping the patient. When young therapists ask me for advice on doing treatment, I tell them that they shouldn't treat anyone that they are not interested in. They can be ambivalent, but they can't really dislike the person at first meeting or have little or no interest in them. I also tell them to think hard about what they are feeling toward any prospective patient, what that patient needs to experience in treatment, and what they might need to get from that patient to make the relationship work. I emphasize conceptualizing the match basically as a doable blending of the analyst's and patient's personalities, a topic I pursue in detail in Chapter 7. This usually includes some measure of shared early experience, no matter how different the analyst's and patient's lives appear to be. It goes without saying, of course, that all of this information is processed in the interests of creating the most effective focus on the patient's experience. I think we need to have both pleasurable and unpleasurable experiences. The question is, why is this idea of our role in the treatment process so controversial? Again, I think it reverts back to the fear of doing harm and the conviction that we need to martyr ourselves in order to do our job effectively and ethically. There is little to no room for conceiving some level of personal benefit for the therapist as normal, healthy, and inevitable, even though we all experience it on a regular basis. Nor is there much acknowledgement that we will also regularly feel boredom, disinterest, alienation, schadenfreude, anger, disgust, and shame. Embracing our motivations. Embracing our early motivations for becoming therapists, especially our narcissistic needs and guilt, can help maximize the healthiest aspects of it in the treatment situation, and we can openly think and talk about how we need our patients. Acknowledging how this work helps us to find ourselves, maintain ourselves, and transform ourselves is essential to doing it well. I believe that both an overall examination of how and why we became therapists, what we as individuals are particularly looking for and gratified by in the process, and in what ways we are limited by biases formed in childhood, could open up a whole new dialogue. That dialogue would include how our emotional responses can create new pathways for positively impacting our patients. For example, a colleague who read this chapter noted that I am essentially challenging the therapists who I believe are too passive in their approach to the work, just as I challenged my mother's passivity. I longed for her to be more proactive and, consequently, urged therapists to be more proactive. During my early adolescence, I became aware of my own passivity and worked hard to become more assertive. Admittedly, I overcorrected a bit, but then achieved more moderation as I worked through some of my defensiveness in my personal analysis. However, once I began practicing from a traditional analytic stance, I became aware of how constrained I felt as a human being, and even more aware of my patients' frustrations. I did not feel that I was adequately responding to them. But when I spoke to my analytic supervisors about this, I was told that this high level of frustration was a normal part of the process. I was urged to maintain my neutrality. As I began my own treatment, I discovered that I also felt frustrated and blocked by my analyst's refusal to acknowledge her feelings and participation. One might say that overcoming passivity and the fear of acting has been a theme in my life and is therefore a theme in my development of theory and technique. Again, this does not mean that my views are either correct or incorrect, idiosyncratic, or widely generalizable. It is for the audience to decide. The analyst's persona. The analyst as arbiter of reality has been arguably replaced by the analyst as good enough mother, who is more of a companion on the journey to self-awareness, seemingly not in possession of either the duty or the ability to direct the analytic process. Nowhere is this emphasis on not knowing more evident than in the current popularity of enactment, discussed in Chapter 5. This does not mean that the analyst is not involved and working hard to understand the patient and the process. Rather, it is a statement reflecting the move away from knowledge and authority to the elevated position of not knowing. The elevation of not knowing emanates from the belief that we have a very limited capacity for awareness of either what we are feeling or what the patient is feeling. It is my position that what began as a laudable rejection of the analyst as all-knowing to a humbler awareness of our limitations has now become so all-encompassing that it discourages analysts from claiming any real knowledge or skill. I say more about this in Chapter 7. Mills argues for a more flexible approach to analytic knowledge and authority. What perhaps appears to be the most widely shared claim in the relational tradition is the assault on the analyst's epistemological authority to objective knowledge. Why not say that knowledge is proportional or incremental rather than totalistic, thus subject to modification, alteration, and interpretation, rather than categorically negate the category of an objective epistemology? Are there no objective facts? Would anyone care to defy the laws of gravity by attempting to fly off the roof of a building by flapping their arms? Knowing has become a synonym for arrogance and reductionism. Not knowing presumes a more enlightened willingness to discover, an idea central to Buddhism. But this presumes that somehow what needs to surface will do so by virtue of this ongoing empathic stance. I have not found this to be true in my practice. Witnessing is valuable, but it is not enough. I find that although certain patients need very little direction and may even prefer to be left alone, many need ongoing gentle probing, interpretation, and confrontation. The analyst as good object. An equally challenging concept centers on the idea that successful treatment depends on the analyst consistently being the badly needed good object in the patient's life. It is hard to argue the desirability of the analyst having qualities of empathy, patience, and a reasonable degree of kindness and good character. But as I discussed throughout this book, the analyst as good object can foreclose or distort when held as an expectation. The idea of creating an opportunity where our patients can truly be free to discover themselves is probably closer to what most of us would actually subscribe to as an ideal. Yet the impact of Winnicott's good enough mother proposition seems to have taken hold in a way that suggests a nurturing, self-sacrificing stance that, to my mind, leaves little room for much working through of negative transference or countertransference emotions. In spite of Winnicott's obvious intention in defining the mother's role in relation to the infant as necessarily imperfect yet good enough, the adoption of his position to psychotherapists seems to have morphed into the good enough therapist being almost perfect. This may be due to the fact that Winnicott's case reports, particularly with regard to his psychoanalyst patient Margaret Little, centered on deviations from normal practice, including extended sessions, holding and stroking, and prophylactic hospitalization when he went on vacation. These heroic measures may have deliberately or inadvertently set the stage for defining good enough in terms of above and beyond the call. Perhaps this explains why the good enough mother persona appears routinely in current case reports, often emphasizing the analyst's unending kindness and willingness to sacrifice rather than his or her skill. As Mendelsohn has pointed out, the therapist may try too hard to avoid mistakes or may feel obligated to take on the part of a new, good or contrasting object. These forms of avoidance and over-conscientiousness may water down potential bad enough experience so that challenging analyst issues are only half-heartedly engaged. In a recent edited volume of self-criticism by relational analysts, Mark discusses how there is increasingly only room for the analyst's good me. Schofield and Jennings make the point that unconscious, dysfunctional motives for becoming a therapist, for example, voyeuristic tendencies, the need for power, can and do exist with altruistic and caring motives. The problem is not that we are secretly destructive or negative people pretending to be good. The problem is that we are so invested in being good and doing good for others that it is difficult for us to look at our normal human failings and desires. More importantly, this reluctance has been integrated into our theories, our persona, and our clinical preferences. Buechler has spoken eloquently about our need for reparation and the tendency to be overly critical when we fail to meet the high standards we set for ourselves. She disagrees with Slackauer's use of the terms sins and delinquencies, fearing that this terminology only fuels the analyst's tendencies toward excessive guilt and shame. She makes a cogent argument for therapists to extend some of the same compassion to themselves that they extend to their patients, working on identifying repetitive countertransference patterns rather than identifying sins. I believe that when we are ashamed as well as regretful, the strength we need to face our regrets may be sapped. Instead of being able to rise to the occasion of courageous self-confrontation, we feel shame's need to hide ourselves. It is impossible to simultaneously satisfy the essential task set by shame and regret. We may not be able to confront what we also deeply need to cover up. I agree that shining the light of curiosity on our own behaviors, rather than negative judgment, ultimately leads to greater insight and responsibility. The analyst's vulnerability. Arguably, classical analysts prided themselves on becoming the bad objects, while relational analysts now pride themselves on being the good ones. Is our need to see ourselves as the good mother an unintended result of analysts no longer being able to write the patient's negative responses off as transference? Now that we believe in our own participation, it is harder to accept the patient's negative assessments without being too personally threatened or guilt-ridden. Safran and Moran's expansion of Tronick's concept of rupture and repair may have inadvertently contributed to the popular notion that the therapeutic value of rupture resides in the analyst's willingness to assume responsibility for his or her participation and work quickly to restore peace, although this was not their intention. Many writers have questioned whether or not we are too quick to squash any conflict when it arises, even if it means placating a patient who is being unreasonable, in the belief that the therapeutic relationship will be damaged if we do not. In reality, Safran and Moran said something quite different about countertransference and conflict. Many therapeutic orientations assume that countertransference is at the heart of contemporary psychoanalytic technique. Despite this fact, systematic attempts to spell out the iterant processes involved in harnessing and working constructively with the intense...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.